You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. And on this edition, this is possibly the most interesting episode that I could possibly put together, as we're on the road to Bleeding Gums Wrestling, Wire and Ice. I've had three chats with AC from Bleeding Gums Wrestling, and every time I've said this man's name, talk about Joe Hendry and he appears. Every time I've said this man's name, shiver goes down my spine. It's doing it now, and I haven't even said it yet. I am joined on this edition by the man who will be taking part in the first ever no rope barbed wire match on July 20th in Perth, Alton Thorne. Welcome to the show.
It's an absolute pleasure to be here. I'm here mostly here just to see if you make it to the end, to be honest.
I'll be honest, I've already got a little tingle thing going just thinking about all the possibilities that will be said during this interview and show, but I'm sure we'll be okay. I've survived AC's chats, but I'm gonna find out about your experiences actually in the deathmatch environment and actually taking all these disgusting is probably the best way to put it.
Let me just say first, I wanted to put you over a little bit actually. Which I'm sure, you know, it probably doesn't usually happen at the start of the podcast, but I'm going to go for it anyway, because I've been, I like to keep my eye on like the comings and goings. So when people are doing podcasts about deathmatch, I'll try and catch them when I can. So I've seen all three of your interviews with Andy, and I think it was clear from the first one, you're not a massive deathmatch fan. You can understand that there might be a time and a place for it for other people, but you're clearly not a massive deathmatch on his form to discuss it. You've put it up on the website. You guys have been really goddamn helpful to getting the word out in Scotland about what we're doing. So I appreciate that. You know, I can see that it does make you shiver. It's not, you know, it's not even always pleasant to talk about, but the fact that you're platforming us and helping us get the word out, really appreciate it. So thank you very much. I'm happy to come on the show.
Well, thank you. Yeah, like I've said with Andy as well, it's like, yeah, I know it's not for me, but I know people will enjoy it. I mean, if I see shows that are just purely like just wrestling, tech wrestling for all their matches, I'm no interest in that either. So it's just finding a middle ground. And to be honest, it's not just my website. It's for people to know about what's there, and deathmatch wrestling's part of that genre of wrestling that's around. So I had no issues at all about platforming Bleeding Gums, because I did ask around. A couple of people that I knew that liked this kind of style, and they knew Andy, they knew the guys, yourself and the guys that are on it, and I was like, I have no issues platforming this, and I'm glad that
that's one of the things that Andy's done really, really well, is getting experienced wrestlers. He's, you know, as a fan, he built up a lot of connections over the years by coming to the shows early and cleaning weapons down and, you know, doing the podcast and trying to spread the word for us. So he had a decent sized phone book, and he's utilized it completely, because you've basically got the best of British deathmatch wrestling all across that show, and he's also trying to bring through a few of the Scottish guys to give them a platform to do it. And I don't mean like new Scottish guys, I mean like Luke King Sharp has finally got somewhere where he can go as crazy as he wants to go. And we all know that Luke King Sharp's wanted to go crazy for quite a while, you know, and now he's being given that opportunity with guys like he wrestled Big Fucking Joe on the last show, you know, who is, I would say, the kind of face of UK deathmatch at the moment. So I think that's one thing that Andy's done really, really well, is making sure that this is a proper deathmatch show with quality talent, names that people will know, even bringing in people from America that people will know, just to give the fans something a little bit extra. So yeah, Bleeding Gums is the real deal. It's the proper thing.
So we'll get back onto that, because we'll be speaking about Wire and Ice for a good portion, because you've got, well, again, a historic match, as I mentioned right at the start there, with Jack Harrop coming up. And I know that let's ease you into that, because I know you're going to have a possibly quite an intense word and story about your thoughts on Jack Harrop. So we're going to go cliched podcasting questions right back to the start. How did you become a fan of pro wrestling?
So I was a fan of pro wrestling before I've got active memory. There are pictures of me at like 3 years old, 4 years old, getting wrestling stuff for Christmas and stuff like that. So like, I don't know. I know how it would have happened. My nan was a huge fan of the World of Sports stuff in the 70s and in the 80s when that was one of four things that was on TV at the time. So a lot of families sat down and watched it. My nan watched it a lot. So I would have been round at her house and wrestling would have been on, and it would have been something that I was clearly showing an interest in because they started buying me wrestling stuff. From what I can remember, my earliest wrestling memories are my nan had this giant like pull-out VHS cabinet, and the most interesting VHSs in there were purple, and they were WrestleMania. And I used to take them out, and there'd be Hulk Hogan, Andre the Giant, Ultimate Warrior on the cover, and I'd be like, what is this magic? Like, what are these crazy things? And I just remember she had multiple sclerosis, so she would sit in her armchair, and I would sit next to her in her wheelchair, and we would watch wrestling for hours when I was a kid. So that's where the love for it really started, the bonding with my nan, and, you know, kind of vicariously learning to love it as a child.
I love the WrestleMania VHS has always had that purple line for ages. I mean, you can't see it because the mic hides it. Let me see if I can bring it down. Just about see it. I've got WrestleMania 4 behind me. Just
The double one. Love it. That was the one. I know the show isn't the greatest, but that double VHS set is, when I think back to pulling those out, that's the one that fascinated me. It was like, there's two videos in this one. Like, it just blew my mind as a kid.
I took that one down to my first ever Scottish indie show, and I got it signed by Ted DiBiase. And he was like,
oh, that's amazing.
He got his phone out, and he's still got a picture of, like, it's him hitting Hulk Hogan with a chair, I think it is. He's still got that on his phone as he scrolled through it. Show me it. It
would have been in the main event, right? Of that show.
It was him and Savage in the main event, yeah.
Yeah. So amazing. That's fantastic.
I love that. I've got a bunch of VHSs at my parents, and it's the purple ones. Every time I saw them in a car boot sale or Saturday market, I was like, yeah, you're coming home with me. I will be paying my £5 and taking that VHS home.
I was exactly the same. And then I would start, you know, when I was in a shop, I would see Power Slam, and then I'd start buying Power Slam, and that started the descent into slightly more extreme and bloody wrestling, because Power Slam was pretty much the only magazine in this country that had graphic pictures of like Japanese wrestling and Funk doing their thing. And like, so that then was like my through point into the idea that there was more, like there was a grander scale than just the WWE, started to come from magazines that I would buy. And then Mick Foley appeared in WWE, and that the rest is history. That's when I, like, from then I was always going to be a wrestler, I think. After I saw Foley do the Mankind stuff, it was like, that's what I want to do.
Was it just the extra, like the extra to the wrestler? Because I mean, when you started then, WrestleMania purple VHSs, it's all very, very family friendly, big moves, nothing really too extreme. But yeah, Foley going through tables and adding that little bit of just extraness to his act, was that was just for you?
Yeah. It definitely, well, so my dad was a professional boxer and like a multi-martial artist, and he didn't like pro wrestling because he would always say that he could spot the gaps in it, right? Like if he was doing a real fight, then you couldn't use a lot of the moves that you use in pro wrestling. So he kind of didn't really like it and kind of looked down on it. But when Mick Foley was doing things, I always felt like I could say, look, this guy's putting himself through hell, right? Like there's a realness to this. He's actually hurting. You can see that he's doing things that other people aren't willing to do. And it felt to me like it nullified that wrestling is I'm not sure it did, I'm not sure it did. What really, really, what strikes me now looking back is the thing that really got me into Foley wasn't so much the tables and the tacks and all that, although I do love that stuff. It was that his character, his personality was so different to everybody else's on the card. He was performing in a different way. It was a much more internal performance. He drew from a lot of kind of pain, and it was just not a character you'd seen before. And I just felt more connected to that than I'd felt connected to, say, Hulk Hogan or The Undertaker, who had previously been my favorite wrestler. So really, it wasn't even about the violence. It was about the connection I felt to the wrestler that then just curtailed into what I'm now doing, I guess.
I suppose when you say it like that, when your Hogans and what have you, they were speaking to everyone. They were speaking to a stadium. They were speaking to an arena. Whereas Foley, much like Jake Roberts kind of thing, they were speaking to you. They were directing their conversation 100%. To you kind of thing. And I get that. I get why it just looked into the camera, looked into your eyes, and just told you what was going to happen, told you how he felt, was open and honest about how he was going to destroy an opponent, how he was going to make their pain, his pain transfer to them. And it's see why that resonated for anyone watching, especially Mick Foley. I love Mick Foley. So that's amazing. So it wasn't as much the tax. It was, but when we're talking about things like the more extreme side of things, do you think with your dad being a boxer, and of course he would have obviously tried to avoid it, but he'd be getting punched, there'd be blood, there would be things like broken noses and what have you. Did that kind of numb you a little bit to a bit more of the violent side of wrestling?
Okay, I think that, yeah, that to say the very, very, very least, because then this actually brings us on to the nettles thing. Now, my dad was an extreme athlete. He used to do kind of extreme nature courses where you'd have to go into nature barefoot and carry trees and, you know, all this kind of intense. Like, he trained in martial arts that were very, very strict in there. Okay, so when he did his karate black belt, for example, he was literally wrapped in nettles whilst he did that. Because the idea is that things like pain can be controlled by your mindset, by your focus. So wrapping you in nettles won't even affect you if your mind is on the carters, on doing the thing that you're there to do. So I used to see my dad with, like you say, come back injured with black eyes, broken nose. I used to see him wrapped in nettles. And I was completely desensitized to it. Completely desensitized to it. It became normal for my dad to be beaten up. In fact, it was beneficial that he was getting beaten up because he brought home a lot of money. So it was completely, completely desensitized to that kind of violence, and always being told that pain and fear and these kind of things are all in the mind, and you can earn control over them. So when I was asked whether I did want to start doing deathmatch, that was 100%. That was what came to mind, is, yeah, I can do this because the pain is temporary. It's something that is going to happen, but it's worth it for the response, for the emotion, for what you can derive from the fans in those moments. It's just in the mind, you get through it and you move on to the next one. So yeah, 100% desensitized.
And it'd make you search out, we're talking about how you feel about the things you've done in deathmatch wrestling, but because of that, did you feel like you had to search out more and more extreme things to maybe get that kind of that feeling of like, oh my god, that might be a bit too far kind of thing? Did that kind of send you down a rabbit hole, so to speak, of I don't know, Japanese deathmatch wrestling, CZW and all that kind of stuff?
Yeah, I think that I was never squeamish about any of it. I was watching it from quite a young age. So it wouldn't have affected me in the same way that it affects other people. And by the time it was my time to do it, I was more than willing. And it didn't seem like, it didn't even seem like an issue, really. It was just, so for me to get to the point where I was doing death matches was really slow process, really. It took about 7 years of my career. Because really what I was doing for a lot of the time was doing family shows and like street fights where I could get them and trying to find a way into that deathmatch world. So as a wrestler as well, it never seemed like I was jumping into things really quickly. It seemed like a slow and gradual process, and eventually this is where I got to. But I would say that from day one, I was always intending to do death matches because I loved them when I was younger. I thought that I'd be really good at them, and yeah, that's how we get to where we are now after this conversation, I suppose.
One thing about the nettles, and I'll probably bring it up again, but it's just popped into my head. My wife after I spoke to Andy the first time, and I went through about, oh, he was telling me about this guy did this with weed whackers and this with the glass, and oh, and there was this guy who uses nettles, and she was like, what? Sorry? No. That was the one that caught her. And she's kind of got over it, even though if I do mention your name, she does pause for a moment. But her question was very left field, which was, she heard, it's a rumor, that if you rub yourself with nettles, it builds your immunity to hay fever. Do you get hay fever?
No, I don't get hay fever. I haven't got hay fever. I've been using the nettles.
Yeah, two plus two, possibly. But
that's the nettles actually, like, don't even hurt anymore. Like, I'm kind of just accustomed to them. Like, I'm not eating them or making them into nettle tea or anything, so I'm not really getting any benefits, but they don't hurt anymore, so I don't have hay fever, so maybe.
We do have a question about, that's David Grant, he did ask, do you like nettle tea, so you don't drink it, so that's
no, that I don't drink any hot drinks at all, so.
I'm the same, I don't know whether it's just a childlike thing, but I hate tea, coffee, anything like that, give me...
Can't get into one.
No. Do you feel like a child though when people like, oh, do you want tea or coffee? It's like, no, it's okay. We've got diluted.
I'll take a can of Coke or a juice. Yeah, it's pretty embarrassing, but like, I mean, at this point, I'm just there's not that much that like I get like embarrassed about anymore. Like, I've put myself in some very strange situations in public places at this point. Like, I've done some pretty weird things. So, asking for a soda, you know, a can of pop is just par for the course these days. I don't feel too bad about it.
I know. It's just imagine, bit like covered in blood and that, and they go, "Oh, do you got coffee? No, I'll have a squash, please." kind of thing. So from that point, you went to training then, with the eventual intention of it being you wanted to get into the deathmatch style. But like you say, 7 years of doing the family circuit before that kind of happened. What was the scene like where you were? Was there training nearby? Was it something that you could get into easily?
So training was nearby. I live in Nottingham, and there's a school called House of Pain, which is a well-known school. A lot of really quality wrestlers have come out of that school. So Kanji, who tags with Emerson Jane, she's from House of Pain. Joseph Connors, who's in WWE, House of Pain. Gabe Kidd in New Japan from House of Pain. And I once heard JR say, you can tell how good a school is by the quality of the people that come out of it. I've just reeled off three like top tier talents that either on indies or signed to big companies. So I was very lucky to have a very good school essentially around the corner from me, or 20 minutes away from me. But in terms of wrestling scene at that point, not really, right? We were getting to the point when I started training where Mark Andrews and Will Ospreay and a few other guys were starting to come through and was about to go through the boom, which had ICW and Progress and these companies that suddenly got lifted, but was a couple of years out from that when I started training. So it was still when I first went on a show, that we were averaging 35 people a show in a place called Beeston. Horrible atmosphere, no noise at all. The least I ever wrestled to back in those early days was 3 people, and 2 of them were the parents of one of the wrestlers. So, you know, it was when I first started, it was rough, but I kind of came in at a good time because wrestling started to take off just as I came through. And I ended up wrestling with, like I say, kind of names that have gone on to really good things. So I had a pretty good, strong base to start with.
I can't imagine what it'd be like to wrestle in front of 3 folk, just to kind of, it's very difficult to do the old come on guys and the clapping along and the foot stamps when there's only 3
you,
people.
I'll tell you how it was. It was really freeing because it didn't matter. So we just kind of, we still had to put on a show. It's 3 people that are paid to get in. So it was really freeing. We went out and just had a fun time. And actually, I worked my match completely, and it was the first time I'd ever done that. So it was a good learning curve for me. I tried things I hadn't done before. I remember that show quite fondly, really. Mm-hmm. But you can't look at it negatively. You have to go, right, here we go. Then there's 3 people. They've paid a £5 a ticket. That's £15 on the door. Let's go give them a show, because they deserve the same show as if there'd been 200 people in that room, you know, mm-hmm. is what it is.
And I suppose, like you say, don't want to look at it negatively, because at the end of the day, this is something you're trying to make a thing, make a career of. And if you're gonna balk at the first hurdle, or there's only 3 people out there, what's the point? Then what's the point of you even trying at that point if you're gonna
exactly
give up then? So yeah, I was noticing when I was going through the old cage match, because that's the Bible for finding out where people are and what they've done and who they've wrestled, and there's obviously loads missing, because there always is. From my records here, you're in your 10th year of being a professional wrestler, and
that's right.
You mentioned Gabe Kidd, and he's kind of a good barometer, I suppose, for yourself to kind of see how you progress. So your first match with him, according to the Germans, was 2015, and then you had another match again in 2018 as part of a tag team. So in that 3 years for yourself, how did you feel like your progression had gone? Because I suppose 3 years in the wider scope of wrestling is not a long time at all. But yeah, for yourself, how did you feel those 3 years were?
I think I grew exponentially in those few. I think the first few years of wrestling are the biggest learning curves anyway. When you're learning, I think after 5 years, I kind of knew what some crowds would like and what other crowds wouldn't. I had a decent handle, because just through repetition of doing it in front of crowds. But for those first few years, you're just trying to feel your way through it, figure out what works for you and what doesn't. So, for example, like I don't remember what the advice was, but I asked Gabe Kidd and Joseph Connors for some feedback on a match, and they gave me opposite advice. And I just thought, well, how do I know what's right then? What do I need to do? But what you learn is, not everything's going to work for you. You have to figure out which bits apply to you and which bits don't. And not all feedback is perfect. You have to take the bits that are going to apply to your character. Mm-hmm. So I think actually I learned a hell of a lot in those 3 years. And if I went back and watched those 2 matches, I think the quality would be much, much higher on the second one. Plus, by that time, I was tagging with Barricade in that match. And Barricade was a long-time pro, a big guy who was kind of teaching me how to be a big guy, because I was doing too much. I was bumping around. And he was like, no, you can slow down these moments. And his timing was perfect. So we were against Gabe Kidd and Saxon Huxley in that match. And I remember there's one moment where Saxon Huxley goes to pin me, and it's 2 9/10 that Barricade cuts it off. And it's just little things like that that you pick up from tagging with somebody who's got all that experience. He's retired now. He retired over COVID, but like, for me, at that period, working with guys that are much better than me, I got good quite quick. Like, I was really, really lucky in that respect.
Was the Alton Thorne alter ego, was that always kind of there? Was the baseline always going to be that kind of rough and ready, like brawler kind of style that would just get in and about and just smash people? Was that always kind of the baseline for it, or did that evolve?
I think so. It started off more like Abyss, but it wasn't really intended to be. I just hadn't figured out how to do it yet. So people started booking me to be like a monster. But I'm 6 foot. I'm not like the hugest guy in the world. In UK wrestling, that's relatively tall, but I'm not like a massive guy. So I didn't think that a monster thing like fully worked for me anyway. So I quite quickly skewed away from that. I wanted to be a brawler. I wanted to be a heel. I wanted to be the guy that if he walks into the pub, your mates all turn to each other and go, "Shall we go somewhere else?" You know, that was who I wanted Alton Thorne to be, like rough and ready and nasty. And also like just wearing street clothes, like a baggy, like, because I was the characters I liked as a kid all wore leather jackets and sunglasses. And I thought that was really cool for some reason. But then when you get into the wrestling business, you realize that's quite passe and nobody does that. Well, I was like, no. I'm just going to wear a dirty trench coat and march down to the ring and make it as grimy and as underground as I could possibly try and make it. Because I just felt that with my aggression and my facials, I'd suit that role quite well. And I think that's pretty much what I do everywhere now. Like, yeah, face or heel, even on family shows as a face, I still kind of play the Alton Thorne that you see at Bleeding Gums, just like a toned down and nicer version of it, really.
Well, I was trying to catch some matches with you while I should have been doing actual work for the job that pays me to do this, pays me to be able to do these outside of work hours. And I caught a clip of I think it was a tag team match. You can't remember who your team with, but I know Ivy was at the opposite side of the ring, and I could see that yourself. Yeah, you kind of had that kind of hunched over like monster kind of vibe about you. But then Ivy was the heel, so she was like saying you wouldn't hit a woman, and it was just hilarious that all I heard from that point onwards go, "I'd hit a woman," and then you came in and everyone was going, "Yeah, here. Hit her." It's like, yeah, I love wrestling.
The fans really wanted me to punch that woman, which is really bad, isn't it?
it shows the quality of your character that folks just go, yeah, okay, we'll see that. And the quality of Ivy's character that they went, yeah, we want to see her get punched. That would be ace as well. So
it's how you play it, right? Like, we kind of played it a little bit for comedy. Like, it was never supposed to be taken too seriously. If I'd have come into the ring and said, "Right, I'm going to punch you in the face, Ivy," I don't know if people would have felt quite the same way about it. But me and Ivy, like, Ivy knows how to get heat. Like, to the point where people would be quite happy to see a big fella boot her out of the ring. Like, they'd be quite happy with that. She's handy for that kind of thing.
So we'll fast forward a little bit then to you finally getting that deathmatch kind of experience. So all these years of doing brawls and hardcore matches and it being a bit tamer than you'd like them to be. When was your first proper advertised deathmatch, and was it everything you hoped for and more?
It was a no ring deathmatch in a pop world in Derby, and it was me versus Danny Darko versus Big Fucking Joe. So already two of the biggest names in British deathmatch, because there weren't many. It was a very small pool when I first started. It was the Deathmatch Outlaws and a couple of guys at Rise, and that was about it. So they were two established names, and it was my debut. We didn't have a ring. It was the first time I'd ever wrestled without a ring. Was it everything I expected it to be? Well, Big Fucking Joe had double booked himself that night. He came down from TNT in Liverpool, got lost on the way to the building, and turned up about 10 minutes before our triple threat match. So we planned pretty much nothing. Which, for your first death match, when you're using glass and barbed wire and a lot of things that you've never experienced before and you don't know how much they're going to hurt, it's probably quite a scary prospect. You'd like to have some kind of idea and plan of what you're doing, right? But that's, I think that test, that moment, that first one for me was the thing that told me that I was made for it, that I could do it, because I actually felt quite zen. It was out of my control by that point, and there was no way that I could turn out, like, back out of it. So I was kind of like, well, we'll do what we do, you know? I'm just going to have to go out there and play it by ear. And I really enjoyed the match. I think, you know, for three people that I'd never wrestled either of them before, we discussed the match for very, very little time. I thought it went as well as it could have done. And I clearly impressed those two as well, because they both told me how well I'd done and thanked me and congratulated me after the match. And they both gave my name to other bookers since to try and get me booked elsewhere. So, yeah, was it everything I hoped it would be? No, probably not. I would have probably wanted, like, to know where we were going and to build to some big spots and stuff like that. But actually, it gave me a pretty good idea of what Deathmatch was going to be like overall. Sink or swim, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I think for some people that's probably the best way. Is like you're saying, you're no control of it. It was like, well, this is happening now. There's nothing I can do about it. Whereas if you got 3 days notice or you had the whole day to think about all the things that could go wrong, I suppose, think about, oh, we're doing this bit. Oh, what if this happens? What if the glass goes into somewhere that doesn't, don't want it to go?
Exactly.
It makes you make mistakes, I suppose.
And if you spend too much time, like you say, yeah, it does. It does make you make mistakes. If you spend too much time worrying about it, then you're focusing on the wrong things. And if you focus on those things, then you're more liable to make mistakes. What you need to be focusing on is the standard stuff that you would focus on in a wrestling match. So your energy, you're making sure your bumps are safe. And as long as you're doing the stuff that you would usually do in a functional standard wrestling match, then generally you'll get through them pretty safely.
Is there anything that you've had so far that it's one and done? You're not doing that again if you could possibly avoid it?
There was a couple of things that I said were a one and done, and I've done them again since. Right. So I don't think there are any definite, like, the only thing that I would never do is like fall from a height, because I'm too heavy set for it and I do myself some serious damage. But anything else, I'm kind of mostly game. As long as I feel like I'll come out of it alive and not too, so that I can still do my standard shoot job, then I'm game for pretty much anything.
There's a picture that Kyle Watt put up, because he did the second show for Bleeding Gums, the photos for it, and there was a moment that he sent me specifically, because he's a dick, the syringes. That possibly is up there with nettles for me as going, no. Is that something that you look at and go, all right, that's workable, clearly. Could I throw that in there somewhere in the future?
So, I think it's inevitable that I'll end up wrestling Jack Bennett at some point. So at first, when I first saw the syringes, my first thought was, I don't even like getting jabs and injections. I don't want to be using them. And then as soon as I came to terms with the fact that they're Jack Bennett's main weapon, my train of thought then went to, right, okay, so how could I use those in a match then? And it took that long. So again, it's evidence. There's not really anything that I won't at least try and put some thought into using. Mm-hmm. And I think I've got. I won't say what my ideas are yet, but I think I've got some things that I can do with Jack's syringes for our future matches. I've got a couple of brainwaves.
I mean, it must be. It's a different mindset, I suppose, as a wrestler who enjoys that style of deathmatch. Is you look at everything as a potential thing that could happen. So if you're going through B&Q, probably being a perfect example, because there's so many things, so much plunder that is possibilities are endless. 100. But do you kind of do that now when you go to the shops in the big Tesco and you go through the aisles and go,
I think I think you've got to try and be as inventive as possible because everybody's trying to bring something that's memorable. People's attention spans in general have shortened for wrestling. So deathmatch wrestling is doing so well at the moment because it's moments, you know, it's fragments, it's glances. It flies around the internet really quickly because it's like a little meme, right? You can get a 10-second clip that blows up. And you don't really get that in too many standard matches unless there's big dives or those kind of things that really pop off. So it's kind of like a really modern style of wrestling in some ways. And rather than thinking, a lot of people now, take music, for example. A lot of artists now are thinking, what would sound really good in a 30-second clip on TikTok that might blow my song up? It's kind of how wrestling is to a certain extent. Now, personally, I love telling like a story in a match, but I'm still aware that the story isn't the thing that's going to be flying around the internet. It's the moments, it's the little violent second. So I think all deathmatch wrestlers are constantly trying to be creative and think, how can I use this? How can I do that? That's where the nettles came from. It was a creative idea of what is nobody else using that everybody knows hurts, that isn't like going to cut an artery, but is an effective, like people will recognize it as a weapon. That's, you know, that's where that you have to be creative because you can't get lost in the shuffle. Deathmatch wrestling didn't have these many workers in 5 years ago, but now you've got Franco Fate, you've got Tim Strange, you've got Liu Kang, you've got Dean Ford. They're all joining up, right? And there's only so many spots on so many shows. So yeah, I can guarantee you every single deathmatch wrestler is looking around B&Q, and not just around B&Q, around the streets. We're trying to think of something that's going to make us stand out in the next match.
I think that's why things like light tubes are so, I mean, they might be a little bit cliche in deathmatch scene, but they provide a 30-second spectacle. The powder goes poof in it, and it makes it impressive to look at, whereas it might not be as painful as opposed to something else you may do with barbed wire or whatever that may be a bit more intimate and you have to be kind of close up to see. But no, it's fascinating that you're right. That's kind of the world now is snippets, and you see these 30-second videos on YouTube, TikTok. I'm so old. I was about to say the YouTube on TikTok, and then you hear the songs on radio, and you go, I don't know what the song is, and then you hear the chorus. You're like, ah, that's what that song is. I've not heard any of the rest of this. It's fascinating.
Quickly on the light tube point that you just made, well, actually, light tubes don't really hurt that much when they're being smashed over your head, especially when the adrenaline's pumping. But the problem with light tubes is they lay in the ring. You got shards of glass every time you bump him, right? So one of the main issues that I have with light tubes is every time I bump, I'm grinding my hands through them. So I get, like, for example, this one is the kind of cut that I get from light tubes on a regular basis when they're just laying in the ring. So it's not always the thing that makes the visual impact, the thing that everybody notices. It's the after effects of the, the stuff that's left lying in the ring that causes the damage.
I remember, speaking of light tubes, I remember I spoke to Emerson Jane briefly, and because she's very much into the deathmatch style now. And
fantastic at it as well.
One of the things she said to me was hate light tubes, hate them. I would try to avoid them. And I think maybe 3 weeks later, a clip had popped up and she was getting smashed by one of them. And I was like,
yeah.
Wrestlers are a different breed in general. they just go, oh, I'll never do that. And then 3 weeks later, 5 second clip of them getting smashed by them instead. Like, all right, okay, cool. that seems to sum up the concept of it.
We quickly accept our new reality.
It's like, what? It's one of those things where it's going to happen. Why not? Yeah, why not?
Exactly.
Other things that has came into my orbit because of Kyle primarily is Tim Strange getting tattooed at a Bleeding Gum show, which is incredible. Hopefully I'm going to have Tim on in the near future on the podcast, and I'll speak about it at length with him. But again, is that another thing you see going, all right, that's I'll have that in the Rolodex. Maybe I like the sound of that if I'm ever in the ring with whomever that that would do that.
Well, on the last, in the last, well, not the last because he had one a couple of days ago, but in the one before that, Tim Strange branded somebody with a branding iron.
Saw that, yes.
So Tim Strange has got quite a lot of cool shit coming out of the bag. Tim's a dickhead, but he's quite a lovable dickhead. He's always mean to me for some fucking... Like, I was about to say he's always mean to me for some reason, but the first time we ever met, I shoved a bunch of nettles into his mouth, so he's probably got a bit of a vendetta against me. I really like Tim Strange, and I would like us to have matches in the future because I think they would be like big hoss fights, and I like a big hoss fight.
I mean, yeah, that would do it. I think nettles in the mouth, that'll do it. It was funny. I was at the park with my son this weekend, just past weekend, and it had this like big overgrown patch of docking leaves, and I was just like, I knew that I was having a chat with yourself today, and I don't know why, but as soon as I saw it, I was like, oh yeah, I've still got to speak to Alton this week. That's a good reminder there that I got to see a big pile of docking leaves.
I could show you my inbox. I just get pictures of nettles all the time from people. Like whenever people see nettles now, they think of me, which is, I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, really.
I mean, you say you don't drink nettle tea, but I'm sure that if a sponsor came in that would want like get something on your gear saying nettle, I don't know the brands of nettle tea, but I'm sure that there's a sponsorship opportunity there. I don't know if they'd like it. But you know, there's something in the pipeline, hopefully. Scotland then, Bead and Gums Wrestling, which we've talked about numerous times. Was this your Scottish debut for the Ultra Violence referendum?
It was.
So Scotland hasn't really had a deathmatch scene. ICW, they had moments. They had some gruesome deathmatches, and then when the pandemic hit, everything kind of got scaled. Well, WWE kind of got involved, that kind of scaled back like exponentially. Were you aware of, like, have you seen some of the ICW hardcore deathmatch kind of style?
I was a huge fan. I was a huge fan. When they came to Nottingham for did a show at Rock City, I went to that show. They had Sabu on. I was a huge fan of the ICW stuff. I was a wrestler myself by that point, but I was low level, nobody knew who I was, a decent hand, you'd probably say, on smaller shows. That was kind of where I wanted to be at that point in my career. Like, I looked at ICW as like the kind of the closest environment to ECW that we had in this country at that time, and I thought that's kind of where I would fit best. The thing with ICW is that they did have those, like you say, they did have those moments, and I think that they are part of the reason that we've been able to continue to expand it, because they kind of brought the interest back a little bit into that kind of hardcore wrestling. It's a shame that they scaled back. I mean, even when they did deathmatch tournaments, like the first half of the tournament would kind of be not really deathmatch, and then you'd get some towards the end. They were never fully going to throw their weight into the real deathmatch scene anyway. But I do think that if it hadn't been for ICW doing what they were doing at that time, that it would have taken us a hell of a lot longer to get the deathmatch ball rolling now. Because we've got an inbuilt audience in Scotland. The people that love that stuff but don't get enough of it, I think they will come to us now.
Yeah, I mean, seeing the people that do love it, they're going to Kumite, and they're going to Rise, they're going to TNT, they're going down south to see this kind of wrestling. So to finally have it up in Scotland, and at the moment it seems to be increasingly getting closer and closer to where I live as well, which is a terrifying prospect.
Which makes you sound quite nervous, actually.
Which makes me think that at some point Andy's going to go, right, I live in Elgin, so we're going to be like, oh, we've booked Elgin. Yeah, you've got no excuse, you're coming to this one. So like, shit, on this one. But yeah, it's
if you do come, please film it. Please do a little documentary. I would pay good money to see that.
I've already got like hoping plans to do like a live stream. I'm going to record myself watching one of the shows on IWTV. just it might just be me in silence for 2 hours going for the whole time. But I've definitely planned to do that. I'm just finding the time at the moment. But anyway, Scotland. So you've kind of ticked off. It's not ICW, but you've ticked off wrestling in Scotland. When you got there, when you heard Andy's plan for it, were you all in? Because of course you know what Andy's like. You've seen him around at shows. You know him quite well. But yeah, when you heard he was going to run his own show in Edinburgh, and what was your kind of initial thoughts for it?
I think I was one of the first people he asked to do it, and I said yes immediately. Didn't ask about payment, didn't ask about anything at the time. My first thought was, that sounds amazing. Let's get the ball rolling in Scotland. Andy's amazing. Like, in terms of, he probably won't like me putting him over like this, but in terms of a promoter, he's as good, if not better than almost anybody else I've encountered. The money gets paid on the day in full. He puts us up in hotels, and if the hotel is slightly further out, sorts us out travel for the night as well. He goes above and beyond to do everything he can to make sure that we are as comfortable as possible. He's got medics in the back, fully trained professionals patching us up immediately. It's a genuinely professional outfit what Andy's doing. He's not, I think there was within like our bubble, our deathmatch bubble, I think there was, when we all saw him putting every single deathmatch wrestler in the UK on the show, on his first ever show, we were all a little bit like, wow, that's going to cost a lot of money. And if he doesn't like get a decent audience, that's straight in the red immediately. And that's quite worrying. But he did everything to sell that show. He was out on the streets, and we pulled in a great crowd. I can't say enough good stuff about the way that Bleeding Gums is run, about how Andy's doing it and how it's all fallen together. I think within two shows, we've already built a decent brand in Scotland. It feels like people... Well, it's three shows now. I wasn't at the... there was the triple backlash show as well, wasn't there, with W3L and Valor. I wasn't at that show because I was at Download at the time. But yet, in that very short period of time, I think people recognize Bleeding Gums, and it has its place, it has its market.
Yeah, and it also, because I mean, you were on the Backlash show, as you say, but it does open you yourself as well to go on a W3L show, to go on a Valor show as well, because now you've got an audience in Scotland that's seen you. And then they're going to go, oh, they've booked Alton Thorne on Valor. Oh, I'm going to go check out Valor then and see what he does with a little bit more possible restrictions on what he can do. But we're going to see Alton Thorne. He was ace at Bleeding Gums. I think it's only beneficial. I know people don't like it at all, don't like that style. I mean, it's not my kind of style, but I know people like it. So I'm kind of in that middle ground of going, not for me, but I know it's for people. And there's going to be people on the other side going, it's not for me, it's not for anyone, stop it, it's not real wrestling. But yeah, it's definitely got a market, and it's definitely as the crowds as I've seen, the crowd's there for it. So yeah, absolutely, go for it.
Yeah, it's like I said earlier, I think the quality of the wrestlers is the reason that it's successful. I mean, the Emerson Jane, fantastic wrestler on any kind of show. I think the difference between UK deathmatch and other countries' deathmatch is the UK deathmatch wrestlers are all family show wrestlers as well. Big F and Joe's on family shows all the time. Lou Nixon does W3L and Valor already because he, you know, lives up north, so it's not too far for him to go. All of us, even Tomby, who is like a little demon, is regularly on family shows in England. So even for somebody like yourself who doesn't like the extremities that we go to, I think we'll at least appreciate that we are genuine wrestlers who have put time, effort, blood, sweat, many, many, many years of grind into getting good at this so that we can go on these shows and entertain people with or without weapons.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the worst thing would be if it's just a bunch of shitbags who don't do anything else but it. They haven't learned how to wrestle, but they know how to hit each other very well with things as well. Yeah. So It's all recognizable names. Even I've recognized half the names that were on this first show and on the first couple shows, which, like I say, I probably wouldn't have come into my remit otherwise. But I recognize some of the names on here, like Lunix said, I recognize that name as well. And it was like, oh, okay, I know a couple of these names going about. And yeah, seeing guys like the Wrestling Couch, the YouTube show, he kind of kept me caught up with what was going on, so I kind of knew what some of the shows were about as well. So it's great
shout out to him and his mustache. He's an absolute legend.
To be honest, the mustache drew me in. I was like, I'm going to watch this man's mustache for a good 10 minutes. I'm okay with that. But yeah, Andy created this network of like podcasters and wrestlers that he'd met through shows, and I think for the first couple of shows he's done above and beyond possibly what his wildest dreams were for it. So but for yourself, you clashed with Jack Harrop at that event, who you'll be clashing with on the 20th as well. As far as getting to wrestle in Scotland, first time in a death match against Jack Harrop, of course, his dad's Iceman, which we'll get on to. That's quite a big match to go into. How did you feel the Scottish crowd was in comparison to possibly a Kumite show or what have you? Was there a difference?
I don't think so. I think actually there's a crossover on a good chunk of these shows. Like you said, a fair few of these Scottish people were coming down to the shows in Liverpool and in Derby anyway. So like, and a lot of the English fans who go to all of those shows came up. I think the fans in deathmatch generally are a lot more appreciative of the action they're being shown than fans on other kinds of shows, because I think there's an immediate recognition of the sacrifice that the wrestlers are making. There's an intensity because the flying stuff and the colours and the, you know, the wildness of it all. And I think that environment breeds a bigger reaction anyway. And I've got to say, in terms of fans, deathmatch fans are the absolute best. They will buy the merch to keep the wrestlers going when they're struggling. They will travel up and down the UK to go to as many shows as they possibly can. They always, always bring energy and like make it worthwhile for us. If they didn't make it feel this good, we wouldn't be doing it, because it hurts and it sucks for weeks. Like I flexed my wrist earlier and started bleeding. You know, it's not how you want to live your life necessarily, but the fans make it worth the sacrifice for those moments. It makes it worth a few days of pain or, you know, a little bit of stiffness, because they give you so much energy, and it's a whole different world, deathmatch wrestling crowd. And that is the one thing I would say to you about coming to the show. I don't think the show might be your flavor of wrestling, but I think you would recognize that atmosphere, mm-hmm. and you can't help but enjoy that. I think for most fans that I've spoken to.
Oh yeah, I mean, I would sit near the back, but I would enjoy it. I would enjoy it. It's just a case of going. I don't want to risk it. Just a case of go down and go, this is horrible. I shouldn't have been here, kind of thing. But I feel like it is something I would enjoy perversely at the end of it. So we'll probably speak about your match against Jack in a bit. We'll get through the questions, because there's lots of questions. These are all nice and lighthearted. So I feel like when we speak about Lust for Death, an Iceman, and your upcoming match with Jack Harrop, it's not going to be as nice and friendly about it. So we'll get through, because we've got loads of questions, absolutely loads. So you spoke about music. So we've got Peter MacArthur. Asking, you were at Download Festival, and he was wondering if you could book any band or artist for your own music festival, who would they be?
That's a hell of a starting question. Opeth, definitely. One of my favorite live bands of all time. Heavy, you feel the vibes roll around the room. They're brilliant. I would have the Beatles. huge Beatles fan. Pete and Baz, the old rappers, they'd be on my lineup. I would like to have Prince on my lineup.
This is the question that you're gonna sit and wake up in the middle of the night and go, "Oh, I want them on there as well."
One more. Rage Against the Machine. I would have. There you go. It would be a very varied festival. It would have all kinds of shit on it, but most of it would be quite heavy in one way or another.
Fantastic. We've got David Grant, who had the Nettle Tea question. A question that I'm quite curious about as well. You're always covered in blood, so what shower gel do you use?
Whatever my wife buys.
Fair enough. That's fine. And most importantly, what's your kebab shop order?
Oh well, if it's a kebab shop, then I will. If they've got mushrooms with like blue cheese, I will always get those as a side. But a kebab with lamb and doner with fries on the side.
Right, oh, great, go kebab. I just polished off a pizza before we started this, and I'm already hungry for more. We've got Joey Slade. How much wood would a woodchuck chuck if a woodchuck could chuck wood?
Quite a lot of wood, probably. I don't know. Like,
I've never met Joey, and I just opened by calling him a prick, so that's probably a good starter.
he's actually in my faction, Hellbound. He's doing this on purpose. He's on a wind up. So
I do have a note about Hellbound.
You're right. He is.
That's fine. I'm going to guess that it's very obvious what the answers for the next one question is that you put in. Also, top three people to watch from the Midlands.
The Midlands is absolutely booming at the moment. There's so much talent coming out of the Midlands at the moment. New Wave have a lot of really, really good wrestlers coming out. Luca Romeo has only been on shows for 4 months. He's already absolutely destroying things. Like I think he's going to be something pretty special. Brad Matthews is just coming back from a serious knee injury. Whilst he's been out, he's been doing commentary. He's been running like the front of house at shows, been doing everything he can to stay in the business. With that kind of mentality, I think he's going to go far. The best women's wrestler to come out of the Midlands at the moment is probably ZZ. I think you will start to see her name more and more over the next few months. She's already starting to get some big bookings. So there's three, but honestly, the Midlands is a hotbed for wrestling at the moment. I've got to big up my man Joey Slade. He's 18 years old, absolutely murdering it everywhere he goes. I'll shout out Quintessential as well. There you go. There's some names for you.
England's doing amazingly though. North, the North is a hotbed. I'm finding like so. I my geography is terrible, so I could be mentioning places that aren't in the North. But the likes of North and Solve Pro as well. There seem to be two promotions that there's a lot of eyes on right now as well. And you've had a couple matches in Solve Pro, and they've got a hardcore division coming up as well.
They do. They're trying to kickstarted.
I was going to say, I'm assuming you're going to be all involved in very quickly.
Well, I said on Twitter that I thought it was time that they had a hardcore belt, and it exploded. The comment exploded. And I've immediately shared everywhere. So Shotty Horror immediately developed a belt. So the reason that there's going to be a hardcore title at Soft Pro is because I said, "Oi, why isn't there a hardcore title at Soft Pro?" So you can guarantee that I will be part of the hardcore division there. And North is one of the companies that I have on my shortlist of places that I really want to wrestle. I know Clint Margera wrestles there quite a lot. I'd love to wrestle Clint there. I think we'd do something special.
But yeah, that's two that have came into my radar, and I tried. I've got that much to think about and keep track of up here. That it's very rare that an English promotion kind of squeezes itself in. But those two certainly have, and it's great to see. Speaking of Soft Pro-ish, segueing a little bit, Ian Skinner got a couple of questions in. Ian Skinner obviously is a big favourite here on the podcast. We've had him on a few times, and there are as.
Oh, I can't wait for this.
Oh no, it's quite a nice question. Yeah, ask him about his dad and the nettle challenge.
Right. Well, so I told you a little bit about my dad and nettles, right? So when I was younger, he used to just to wind me and my friends up. He used to pick nettles in front of me and put them in his mouth and eat them. And me and my friends were like, "Oh, you're sick. What the hell are you doing?" And he's just like, "Let's shrug it." And it was just to creep the kids out, basically, because he had no fear of nettles anymore. And that's kind of, it turns out that's kind of where my career's gone. That memory must have like stuck somewhere in the back of my head of my dad trying to creep me out with nettles, because now I'm creeping you out with nettles.
I was going to say the legacy continues.
So yeah, there you go.
Is anyone taking? Is that a thing that you? I don't know if you do that backstage as a joke, that you get people to take part in this kind of challenge, or is it something you just kind of leave to freak out people with?
Well, I find that I can barely get people to use the nettles in the ring, so.
Fair.
But Big Fucking Joe said, "I don't want to use those bad boys at all." So there you go.
I love that he's like Big Fucking Joe, who's like done just about everything and anything in deathmatch wrestling. That's where he draws the line. Like chemical warfare is where he goes, no, thank you. That's before you even bring out the cactus. All that good stuff. Oh, right. Okay. The other question from Ian is, I hate asking this question, but Ian's great. Would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more games, or games, unlimited games but no games?
What? Can you ask me that question again, please?
Right. Would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more games, or games, unlimited games but no games?
What language did he ask this question in? I'm so confused.
It's the question that keeps giving. To be honest,
I think I would need to see this question written down to even decipher what it is.
because he's asked this question so many times, he just puts "ask bacon question." That's it, and I've got to try and find it. I've bookmarked it on my Twitter. That's because I'll never remember how it's said out loud. So I'm like, it's bookmarked now for forever. So it's It's a baffling question. The only people that kind of answer it really quickly are vegans.
Right.
Because of course. It's very easy to answer that way. Or people do play games.
I like bacon and I like games. And so that's all I've got for you on that question, I'm afraid.
Fair enough. Fair enough. So, see how many questions we've got left in here. We've got one on Instagram. We've got Wee James 97 asking, "What's your favourite death match you've been in?"
By the way, shout out to Wee James. I accidentally sent his medium T-shirt to somebody else, so he's been sat patiently waiting for it, and somebody got two T-shirts instead of one. So shout out to Wee James. I apologise for that. I really enjoyed my match with Jack Harrop on that first show. But if I had to say one, I would say my match with Kingsley at the end of season two of Kumite. Kyle Kingsley is not a deathmatch wrestler, but we'd built up a feud over the course of the year that led to a deathmatch. And for his first ever deathmatch, he went all out. I think we had about 30 minutes. We told a really kind of intense and complicated story through the course of the match. And it's the one of my matches that's gone most viral as well. There's a clip of me powerbombing him onto the side of a chair that got a couple of million views on Instagram. So yeah, I'd say that one. I'd say that one's the one that I'm most proud of as a full match, as moments. I think it's got a little bit of everything.
And the final question that I can ask in this section, because one's about your upcoming match with Jack at Wire Nice, is Hustle Malone, And speaking of Hellbound, for a moment, if you could cook a sit down, God's sake, if you could cook a sit down meal, I had easier time with Joey Slade's question. If you could cook a sit down meal for each member of Hellbound, what is he doing? No cop out. I just get him a beer. Get your apron on. Get fancy.
I knew this question was coming, and I still didn't even try and think about what I was going to say. I saw this one on Twitter, and I thought, I don't cook for one. Joey, deep fried Cadbury's cream egg. It's not much of a meal, but he does love them, so you'll have to make do with that. David Grant, like a kind of medium curry, because we're both quite heavy, like beer and cider drinkers. So a decent bit of heat. It's kind of like a pub kind of meal. Yeah, I'd do that for him. Harley, I don't know, because I'd want it to be nice for Harley, and I'm not a very good cook. What do I do best? There's nothing that I'll just order out for Harley and tell her that I cooked it. Something nice from a nice restaurant and convince her that I've done the cooking, because I won't want to give Harley something crap like my out of a pot curry.
I've just laughed at myself there for an hour in. We've talked about some disgusting things when it comes to deathmatch. The first time my face is properly dropped is the thought of a deep fried Cadbury's cream egg, because
I agree.
Oh, that's too sweet.
The most disgusting thing that's been said in this whole podcast by a country mile.
Oh, that's too sweet. Way too sweet. I mean, I scattered myself. I was like 13. I was well into the cream eggs. I had like 10 of them in a day, and that's put me off them for life.
Yeah, I can imagine that's too much, isn't it?
That'll do it. Yeah, that'll do it. Anyway, we'll move on from there. We'll talk about Hellbound then. So,
can we move on from there? Like, quickly.
Yes, because oh god. So Hellbound, then, of course, I know very little, to be perfectly honest, about Hellbound. I know that you've got a lot of belts, and it's quite a group that you've got together, not only for Deathmatch, but also just for shows in general. How did Hellbound come about?
I was feuding with a gentleman, a really good Midlands wrestler, but a complete arsehole, called Sash. Who is kind of like a million-dollar man ripoff. I'm going to call him a ripoff. Basically flashes his cash and pays off wrestlers to do his dirty work for him, but hasn't really got any friends. He had a little group called Money Mountain. And me and Harley weren't getting the job done. Me and Harley have been in Hellbound for years and years and years. So that was just our tag team name. It became a faction because we needed more people to beat Money Mountain. Joey, training at House of Pain, I've known him since he was like 8 years old. He used to sit at the front row of shows watching me wrestle when he was a kid. And he's been training since the age of 10. He's a fantastic little wrestler. So I wanted to tuck him under my wing and hopefully, you know, just show him to different kinds of crowds, because he wouldn't get much chance to do over 18 shows, but I'm putting him in those kind of positions so he gets those different experiences that he might have done. And David Grant was tagging with him at the time. They had this kind of odd couple relationship. I really like David Grant because he's taller than me, so he can do all the like muscle work and I can do all the crazy stuff, you know. He can be the big guy rolling through people. He's a tall, dark and handsome guy, got a lot of charisma, just needed some people to back him and trust him and push him. And luckily, it's fallen, like the four of us just works really well. We've got a woman, a young guy, you know, a big guy and a crazy guy. And it just seems to all click very nicely together. And we kind of cover the Midlands completely. I think we've all got a heavyweight title from a big, like decent sized company in the Midlands at the moment. There's 8 titles between us. So, yeah, and we're breaking out of the Midlands bit by bit. And you'll see Hellbound all over the place, hopefully even in Scotland in a while's time.
And it, like you're saying, it's got that like diverse nature. You can see a member of Hellbound pop up anywhere kind of thing. And I must say, the merch is top quality. It looks incredible for anyone who's into that sort of thing.
Thank you.
That's
the same guy that designs the North stuff that did our design. I think his name is Alec Hugo. I would strongly recommend him because he's fantastic. All the North designs are his. The Hellbound design is his. So go find Alec Hugo on Twitter or Instagram because he's fantastic.
So let's talk wire knives then. So taking place at the Ice Factory in Perth on the 20th of July 2024, for those that are listening to this next year for some reason. Afternoon show, outdoor show, starts at 3:30, doors open 4 p.m. for first bell. You're coming up against Jack Harrop and a match that has got a lot of story behind it. Certainly in Bleeding Gums, possibly elsewhere as well, because you're supposed to face his dad, Iceman, at Lust for Death. He conveniently retired before that match would take place. And I saw your promo about that match, and that was when I went from terrified of you to on board, but still terrified of you. with Alton Thorne. You had a clash at Lust for Death. I'm saying clash in the most, like, that's not how to describe it, but that's how I'll describe it for this moment in time, because I think it was a bit more than just a clash. This is a very heated match that's going to take place historically, no rope barbed wire match in Scotland, Ice Factory, outdoor venue. There's going to be a barbecue. I don't know where to start asking you about this, but when it comes to this match happening, what are your thoughts?
Firstly, I think I'm wearing the t-shirt with the design for the match on at the moment, which is a Sayazawa design. I am incredibly fortunate to, in deathmatch, there are a couple of match types that you really feel like you're a deathmatch wrestler once you've done them. No rope barbed wire is one that is absolutely on my bucket list. To be able to do the first one that Scotland's ever had is really, really cool. Like, it's a kind of self-affirming moment of, I worked hard to get into this deathmatch scene. I put a lot of time into it and, you know, a lot of sacrifice. And when you feel like you're making a bit of history, when you're doing things that people haven't done before, that's a pretty cool feeling. So I'm really hyped for the match itself. I think the stipulation's one of the coolest stipulations in the world. And the match is going to be bloody and nasty and gory and disgusting and exactly what the fans would want. In terms of Iceman and Jack Harrop, first off, Iceman, I've got a lot of respect for. The first time I ever saw Iceman, he was wrestling Mick Foley. Back in 2004, I think it was. In that match was also Steve Corino and Sandman were in that match as well. Like, he's done it all in terms of hardcore wrestling in this country. Like, he was the guiding light. He was the guy that was doing it when everybody else kind of looked down on it. So I've got all the time in the world for Iceman. And Jack Harrop is, some of the matches he's had have been fantastic. Some of the best death matches I've ever seen. Not exaggerating, the first match he had with his dad was easily amongst the best death matches I've ever seen. So it's not to take anything away from either of them. It's not about that. What it comes down to is, I don't want to say nepotism, because that seems like the easy thing to say, that, well, your dad is Iceman, so you had this easy route in. But what I do feel like is that I don't get the respect that I deserve for the work that I've put in to get here. I didn't have people who were in the deathmatch world when I started this. I didn't have anybody. The guys that I knew were Gabe Kidd and Joe Connors. They don't even, like, Gabe Kidd's doing some crazy stuff now. About that time, that wasn't where he was going, you know? I didn't have that background. I had to scrape and claw and send emails and messages and footage and nobody getting back to me, and it's disheartening, and it's I feel like this is where I'm supposed to be, and I fight and I claw, and eventually I make my way into the scene. What Jack Hamp had to do was say, Dad, can I get on some of these shows? And I'm not saying that he's not good. I'm saying it pisses me off that I can barely get a foot in the door at Rise, and he's there every fucking month. And I'm like, I'm as good as him. I've beaten him. I've fucking beaten him. Not only have I beaten him, I broke two of his ribs and put him out of action for a couple of months. Right? He was supposed to have his first booking abroad, and he couldn't go because I put him on the shelf. He was supposed to take his kids to see Santa Claus, and he couldn't even get out of the house. So why him? Why not me? Well, there's one reason for that. It's because of who his fucking dad is, right? So, I don't want to just say it's nepotism this, it's nepotism that, but sure as shit, I want to prove that Jack Harrop isn't as good as me. I've been here. I've worked hard. I've done this. He's been in it for 2 years, and he's already facing Cruel and all these motherfuckers. I'm not afraid to say it pisses me off. I'm not afraid to say I'm jealous of that. But what I will say is I'm jealous for a reason. And the reason is I'm better than fucking Jack Harrop.
I don't think there's much more you need to say about that. It's very clear that this match itself is going to be possibly one of the hardest hitting matches that you're going to be in, because you've got a point to prove. You're not only going to be in there to win, because obviously if you're going to a match without the thought to win, that's ridiculous in itself. But the fact that you're going in with a chip on your shoulder, with that thought of an understandable thought as well, because I mean, Jack is, I've heard nothing but good things about Jack's matches. I've heard nothing but good things, but I absolutely see your point, is he wouldn't be in those positions as early without that connection.
And to be fair to him, he does make the point that it's made it hard for him because he's got this reputation to live up to, right? So it's not as he can't let his dad down. He can't be the David Flair, right? He feels like he has to live up to the legacy that his dad left. And that's great. But if it wasn't for that legacy, you wouldn't be saying this now anyway. So come back to me when you've ground for 10 fucking years. Come back to me when you've worked through injuries, when you've done all this stuff, when you're just sat at home like a fucking crybaby, moaning about your ribs. It just fucking frustrates me, that's all. Just frustrates me.
Well, what we'll do is, so the tickets are available at bleedinggumswrestling.co.uk. Go get your tickets for this. It's July 20th, Ice Factory in Perth. There's a huge lineup already. Not just deathmatch wrestling for those that think, oh, it's just going to be that. There's not. We've got Johnny Storm versus Yuji Maki. We've got David Blaze versus Leonardo Darwin. We've got the match with Alton and Jack Harrop. We've got Michael Caden versus Tombe for the BGW UK Deathmatch Championship. We've got Tim Strange versus Big F and Joe, and Dean Ford versus Luke King Sharp as well. All those matches are all death matches of some form or fashion. We will finish on something a little bit more fun, just because we've got into a little bit of a tense situation here, so we'll have a little bit of fun towards the end. But yeah, for anyone who may be on the fence about it, maybe not just about your matches itself, but if you're wanting to tell someone they should be at the show, what would you tell them?
I would say that you're not going to see another show like it in Scotland, and probably not anywhere else in the world. It's an experience like no other. There isn't another type of show that has this kind of energy in any form of entertainment. I think there are some that come close, like battle rap can be quite intense, and you know, like boxing. There are things, but there's nothing that has the give and take with the audience and all the elements that make pro wrestling so special, and then times them by 10 and make them bigger and crazier and wilder. And that's what I would say. You, until you've experienced it, you don't really know. Like, you don't know. So get a ticket and see if you like it. And it, at the very least, you'll have a wild and entertaining night that you won't forget.
The question we did get in about it, which I know you're not able to answer because it gives away your plan, is from Gordon Craig. What does do you have planned to finish off Harrop at Wire and Ice in the most brutal match in Scottish history?
No, I'm just gonna
you have to get tickets to see it.
Here's the thing, right? In a barbed wire, like, there's not really many places we can go. Like, we're both going to get tangled up. We're both going to get cut up. There's going to be a lot of blood. There's probably going to be a lot of glass. But the one thing that will happen at the end is what happened last time I wrestled him. I'll get the freak out. I'm gonna, if I have to twist his neck so hard that his head pops off and punt it into the fourth row, then that's what I'll do. Simple as that. At this point, I clearly need to prove a point to some of the other promoters out there. So there's nothing I won't do to stop him.
So bring it up a little bit before we finish off here. We talked about bucket list, which was perfect because bucket list is how I like ending some of these conversations. There's so many things that's no rope barbed wire match being on your bucket list. Is there anything that's on there, be it something tiny, something big that you want to tick off? For example, do you want to have a match on a Game Boy Advance cartridge kind of thing? Mm-hmm. Is there something that you think absolutely possible, I would love that to happen on my bucket list?
There's a couple of things. I think there's only a couple of things. Like, a lot of the things on my bucket list were like, get on a poster, be a main event, be in a death match. It's like quite simple, clear goals. Wrestle, earn 3 figures for wrestling, wrestle in front of over 1,000 people. I've ticked all those ones off. So there's 2 left. One, I want to be in a music video. As a wrestler, wrestling in a music video. Don't know why, I've just got lots of friends that have done it and I really want to do it because I bloody love music. And 2, I would like to travel to America to wrestle. Not for any particular reason, not because I've always wanted to or anything like that, just because I feel like it's the last big thing as a deathmatch wrestler that I need to kind of get done is a trip over to America. There's not really any others now. I think I've cleared them all. So they're the 2, a music video and a trip to America.
Fantastic. So before we wrap up here, I'll just let you know it's still 0-0 between England and Slovenia. So you haven't missed anything.
Yeah, I've got it on in the background. And it's like, I've barely glanced at it all because it's been the most dull bullshit. I mean, sorry to bore the Scottish fans. In fact, I probably won't bore them. They'll probably find it quite entertaining. But this is just fucking rammel. Like, so I'm quite glad that I've been doing this instead of watching that, because I'd have had a paltry, boring fucking night.
I haven't watched a single minute of the football, but I've quite enjoyed the Scottish stuff that's been going on. Not the results, obviously, that's terrible, but football's not real anyway. It's wrestling you want to get onto. So if anyone wants to find out more about Alton Thorne, I've survived the last hour and 20 quite comfortably. Like I said, the thing that disgusted me the most in that time is a deep fried cream egg. Where can people find out more about Alton Thorne and Hellbound in general?
On Twitter at Alton Thorne, on Instagram at Alton Thorne Wrestling. I'm not on TikTok. I tried to be, but they kept kicking me off for blood. I can just about cope with Twitter, but Facebook is just a living nightmare of a place now, so I avoid that like the plague. So they're the 2 places: Twitter, Alton Thorne; Instagram, Alton Thorne Wrestling. I share stuff for all the companies I'm at all the time. So if you follow me on either one of those, then you'll get all the links to all the shows and everything that I've got coming up.
Perfect. Well, great. Well, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me today. It's been a fascinating chat. And thanks again.
Hello?
I'm still here.
No worries. Thank you very much for having me.
Right. Have a good one.
It slowed down massively for a second. It kind of froze, but I've got you back again now. It's been a pleasure. Thank you very much for having me on.
That's fine. Yeah. Paused at your side. My internet's decided to die. It's right at the last minute. But anyway. Thank you again.